Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum. Thank you for attending this special event. We haven't had an exhibition of this kind at the bookshop. We're very lucky to have Mushin Kilby. He is based in Malaysia, although he doesn't want to admit it. But I've got a very, very short bio, and you know, he'll go through his works today. Mushin Kilby is a world-renowned photographer and has covered a varied spectrum of work, including art, theatre, dance, music, architecture, news and features, reportage photography. Today he'll be showcasing his work entitled My Palestine Reminiscence, an experience of a photographer concerning Palestine. And will be his travels and photography in Palestine and the iconic images he has taken from the Dome of the Rock, Masjid al-Aqsa, panoramas of Al-Quds Jerusalem, to architectural details from the region. Mushin Kilby's photographs have been published in all major British broadcast newspapers, The Guardian, Independent, Telegraph and Times, as well as numerous magazines with major contributions to Time Out, The Wire, West Africa and F-Roots.
I've done work in various areas and directions in Palestine and for different reasons, so it's a little bit of several things. And this is not my photograph. This is actually an engraving from the 1830s. And what you find is really Jerusalem. It's a classic Islamic city. There are not that many in the world. You know, it reminds me of Fez in Morocco, for example. It reminds me of other famous, historic Islamic sites. But what is there from the 1830s, it looks pretty much like that today. It's built up a bit around it. But what is within the walls of the old city is basically the same, except for what used to be the Maghribi Quarter, you know, which was a Wakaf property for the pious Muslims who settled there from Morocco and Algeria. And that was bulldozed in 1967, the first thing the Israelis did when they took the old city.
So is it the northern top?
Sorry?
Is that northern top? Which side? Could you make a...
I don't have the pointer, so So I mean, what you have here, this is where the Dome of the Rock and the Jami al-Aqsa.
Yeah,
and within the wall of the old city here, at that point, it's also the wall of Masjid al-Aqsa.
Uh-huh.
So, and then along in this direction, so here is the south.
Oh, that's the south, yeah. Okay.
And this is the east.
Yeah, yeah.
So the east wall of that part of the city is also the wall of Masjid al-Aqsa, because Masjid al-Aqsa is quite a large compound. It is not the Dome of the Rock.
No.
It is not Jami al-Aqsa. It's the whole thing. The hadiths about praying in Masjid al-Aqsa and the extra reward in a similar way to extra reward of Mecca and Medina. It's not just in the Dome of the Rock or the Jami, it's in the whole area. Some of it is gardens, some is Musala, there are other small mosques, there's mosque under the ground, there is Masjid al-Barak, where it's believed Barak was tied, and the old city. So this is the entrance to one of the refugee camps, and one of the bigger camps is in Bethlehem. For people in the West, Bethlehem is known as a Christian city because of its associations. It's mixed Christian and Muslim, and it has been, you know, through much of history in the Islamic era, you know. You can't see this in this light, that is the thing. So this is actually basically farming people, village olive farmers. This is actually one of the main entrances into Gaza. This has been closed because this was the Israeli access, which they closed for some years, the Eretz crossing. And when you come in, you come to this. This was the, and the sign said, "Welcome to Gaza" in English and then Arabic and Hebrew. And you can see the broken nature of it. So this was more children in Gaza. This is in a school, and they are singing songs and acting them out. And the songs generally were part of practicing Islam and learning Islam. So, and the cemetery, which is, you know, the place that we all end up and the place that we tend to forget about, but they are always visiting because of the number of deaths. This is the in the Islamic University of Gaza. I gather it was bombed and it's also now closed. On the right, this is where it was a family house. It's in a refugee camp. And it was blown up and the remains bulldozed by the Israelis because one member of the family took part in resistance. And this is his mother on the left, and that's where they ended up living. We were actually working in Gaza. This is when we were making video. And this lady came out. It's in a refugee camp as well. And she said, "What are you doing? You are pointing cameras. You come here, you point cameras. But what good do you do? People talk and nobody is helping us. Only Allah is helping us." And she went, "Only Allah." I actually have another photograph in black and white. She is like this. Yes. She said, "Only Allah. But inshallah, there are people that help." But we didn't see results. For me, I keep thinking all the time of the Crusades because I believe this time is like the Crusader era. And this is disregarding anything that happened in more recent time. I'm disregarding, you know, Afghanistan and Iraq and whatever else happens. And, you know, this is, and different opinions about revolutions in different countries at the moment. This seemed to me, because of the land and the historical associations, it's a repeat of the Crusades. And the Crusaders established a kingdom of Jerusalem and a king, and they held on to that for almost 100 years. And the lesson is that they lost it, you know. And a lot of them losing it was the growing strength of faith of the Muslims. And, you know, whatever the Zionists think, whatever the British government thinks, or the American, the European Union, the French, you know, historically, every empire that rose, it fell. And Israel is another crusader kingdom. Even if it lasts 1,000 years, it will disappear. You know, inshallah, it disappears a long time before that. So what can we do? This mosque in Haifa. And this is partly Ottoman style, and it's in a lot of disrepair because there's still Muslims, Palestinians living in different parts of what was occupied in 1948. Generally, they are a certain amount impoverished, and you know, Islamic sites are not well looked after a lot of the time. So it's but, you know, they are practicing Islam there still. So this is Jarina Mosque in Haifa. In Masjid Ibrahimi, this is the mosque where it's built over the cave, where Ibrahim alayhi salam and his family is buried. The minbar, they say it's a sister to the minbar which was put by Salah ad-Din. So it's almost the same design. The minbar put by Salah ad-Din, in Masjid al-Aqsa, which was on a grander scale, it was destroyed by an arson attack in 1969, and it's been replaced more recently by a replica. This one was a sister, it's a sort of original, so they were carved in Aleppo and made of cedar wood. In Al-Aqsa, the arsonist, he knew very well the cedar wood is full of oil, so it went up a lot. But but alhamdulillah, Alexa survived, but not that member. This one, its counterpart, the sister. This is an orphanage in Hebron. Masjid Ibrahimi is in Hebron. And that's also the same orphanage, part of the food. It had, I think it was 300 orphans and a school. It's, you know, orphans from the casualties of the oppression. And the orphanage, I understand, has been closed because there were accusations of Hamas involvement, and because the Israeli army has authority over Hebron, even though by Oslo that area is claimed to be Palestinian authority, but it's only a lip service. Another house demolished in Hebron. The family living in the tent by it. This is Uncle Rajab. He was a friend of mine's neighbour and a very wiry old man, and who I heard recently got married again at the age of 80, and at the age of 81 had a new baby daughter. And he swore by drinking a glass of his own olive oil every morning. And last year the daughter married, and he was still alive for that. She is 20 and he is now over 100, so it says something for olive oil. That is, especially when you grow your own olives. That's one of the streets in Hebron, and vegetable cellar. Girls learning Quran in one of the Hebron mosques. Nabi Musa, which is a sanctuary and a maqam for Musa alayhi salam. It's in the West Bank near Jericho. There is a maqam, but with many maqams, I will say, except for Ibrahim alayhi salam, that for Nabi Musa, they put the maqam, but it's pretty certain that he is not buried there. But with maqams, very often it's a reminder of some association. A mosaic in a bathhouse in what they call Hisham's palace, because it was the bathhouse and the palace and the hunting lodge and the mosque of one of the Umayyad caliphs. And some of the the ruins of it are quite remarkable. It has a hot water system, for example, in the bathhouse. So I don't know how many hundreds of years it took for Europe to get hot water systems, but they had it there in the desert near Jericho. This is a Sheikh Harb, and he is a Sheikh in Jericho. He is blind, and this was a Braille Quran he's reading. This is a Bedouin. Actually, in the West Bank, there were Bedouin from this area, they have been moved from where they would camp, mainly because the area they will camp is now taken by Israeli settlements. And many people don't speak well of the Bedouin there. And I never found anything that was a problem with them. So anyway, alhamdulillah. This farm that is growing peppers in Jericho. Jericho is very, very rich, fertile farming land, but it's also the center of targeted land being annexed by Zionists. Not only they annexed, and a lot of this food sold in supermarkets in Britain, variously as Israeli or called West Bank or whatever, it comes from that area, from the annexed land operated by Israeli settlers, where they have also Jewish-only roads and things like that. And your car is identified by the colour of its number plate anyway. This, not necessarily for Jewish, but from where you registered the car. So if you are Israeli or Jerusalem, it's yellow, and if it was West Bank or Gaza, it's green or white. And the police and army know you can or can't go there. So there's one boy helping his family on the farm. These are some of, this is after Jummah prayer. This is in Kufa Qasim in Galilee. So this is, according to the Israelis, these are Israeli Arabs. But according to them, they are Palestinians, and just it's where there was the ceasefire line in 1948. They are on that side. This is Olive Grove. You can. And another, this is more olive trees, but this is the land just outside Jerusalem. Behind me, there is a historic mosque and a maqam. They call Nabi Samuel. This is, you know, Samuel, in English, Samuel, the prophet. And there is a maqam. It was recognized by the Muslims because they said, if the Christians and the Jews recognize this as a prophet, we are. But this has been largely annexed by the Israeli army. And they've removed the hilal from the minaret and the dome. You can still pray there, but it's a bit scary because you're surrounded by Israeli soldiers, and most of the Muslims in the area have been forced out. So not all of them. This another, this market, this nuts in Ramallah. And you can't see, this is actually, this in, there's a boy here carrying something, and he, this is in one of the most difficult refugee camps in Nablus. The houses are that close together. You know, they are crammed full of people. Conditions are very bad. It was regularly attacked by the Israeli army. Balata camp. We have a problem because if we that we need the light for filming, but you can't see the pictures so well. So that's the kind of cabbages. I'm obsessed with how large the cabbages are. So this is the market in Ramallah.
We've got another 5-10 minutes before.
So okay. And this is a manual worker in a place called Sheikh Saad. It is a maqam of one of the sheikhs of the area. And this is ladies from a refugee camp, Jenin, which was came under lots of attack from the Israelis, but they'd come back to the area they came from, which is actually just north of Tel Aviv. And there's an Islamic sanctuary, it's called Sidna Ali. It is after a sheikh called Ali, who's buried there. And the Muslims were restoring it. And the Israelis were making fun of them, but they are still working there. This is actually Eid Adha with some of the Muslims from Jerusalem, which, to my great surprise, they went and had picnic in Tel Aviv, in the park. It's partly because there are no parks for them. So they drove, however far it is, 40, 50 miles to Tel Aviv, and hundreds of Palestinians came, had picnics, played games, sports, you know, went on the boating lake. When you saw Israelis arrive at that time, they ran away, apart from the ones taking the money, selling ice creams and hiring boats. So, and this is kind of, you know, general traditional life in the West Bank. That shepherds, I think, from the beginning till the end of time, and the occupation of prophets. Inshallah. And some of the old men on Jummah, they are, this is gathering called Jummah prayer in Al-Aqsa Mosque. And this is actually a lady praying in the Dome of the Rock. It's worth saying the Dome of the Rock is full of women. The women love the Dome of the Rock. All day you can go there will be flocks of women coming and praying behind the rock, in front of the rock, under the rock, because there's a cave under the rock. So, which, and children from the old city, they're praying in Al-Aqsa, but this is an area where there are a lot of archaeological objects just simply laying there. It's the same, more children playing. This is a very, very well cooked casseroles. In the old city, in Mamluk buildings, where the walls are some 4 foot thick, there's an oven just to the right. You can just see the glow of it. And they cooked stews over several hours in that oven. And we had a very delicious feast. This market at the old walls. This is Bab al-Amud, also known as that Damascus Gate. And there's a daily market. The daily market is a whole story of oppression, because it's a historical market. The people came from all over the West Bank and Jerusalem to sell produce. This is just at that gate, and this is inside, and this is down inside. But they come under daily harassment from the Israeli army. You know, you see people being pushed and shoved, their produce scattered and stamped on by soldiers, ceramics being thrown over a wall and smashed. It's the only time I ever lost film in my life was to the Israeli army in this place, because I photographed them doing this, and unfortunately they saw me. So I lost the film. That is... And these two children, the older brother is visiting them. The family was having supper in their house, and an Israeli army jeep went by and they threw a grenade through the window. So this boy, he's lost his lower leg and foot. He lost his fingers from that hand. And the girl is drawing an Israeli soldier being sort of set upon. And a boy who's a victim of a high velocity bullet. Spinning bullet, if it hits you in the foot, part of your leg's gone. This coming from Al-Aqsa Mosque after the Eid prayer, so it's very low light coming across because the sun just came up. Part of the Dome of the Rock. This is part of the constant restoration going on in Masjid Al-Aqsa. And this man was constantly working on plaster carving and constructing stained glass windows. So, and the ayat is about Ibrahim not being a Jew, which is appropriate to the area. This is also restoration of Al-Aqsa. This is on the ceiling of Al-Aqsa Mosque. So he's painting. Can you actually go back to that? Because the brother is painting. I was very high up scaffolding to take this picture. And then he was telling me that, you know, he is restoring this. He's painting it. It's the first time for 300 years this is repainted. And he said the materials they used then were better than now. We also had a discussion, even though the time's short, I have to relate this, but we had a discussion about the visitors to Al-Aqsa Mosque, because he's one of the workers there, and he and a lot of them, they are unhappy that non-Muslim visitors are allowed to come in the mornings before Zuhur and afternoons after Zuhur and before Asr, and they kind of feel unhappy because they say, you know, we make wudu before, and you know, we don't know. They put a cloth over the woman if she's not covered, but maybe she's menstruating, you know, and what good does it do you know, and I was saying, well, it does some good because they, you know, they see something of Islam, but not only that, this place is not only so holy, the third most holy place in Islam, but it's very, very beautiful. So if they can come and look at this beauty, it maybe they start to think, they are told how bad Islam is, and they see this beauty, there's a contradiction, you know. So I was for it, and they said to me, well, okay, brother, but did you meet anybody in your country who came here and looked at this beauty and became Muslim? And I said, well, no. Well, I think maybe their attitudes change or it opens their mind. But I came back, and a couple of weeks later, my wife met a sister in the mosque, and they got talking, and that sister said, you know, I knew nothing of Islam. I was from a village in Kent. I didn't know any Muslims. And I came to visit Jerusalem, and the thing I loved most was the Dome of the Rock. So I came and visited there. And when I saw it, I thought, this is so wonderful. This is so beautiful. How can, these are Muslims who made this. How can they do such a thing? So she came back. All she wanted to do was to read about Islam. And a couple of months later, she made the Shahada. And I haven't managed to go back there, you see. So I'm hoping one day, inshallah, I go back and I'm looking for the brother and I'm going to tell him, you know, I don't care if it's only one, but I'm sure it's more than one. You know, this sister, she saw this and she accepted Islam. I myself, some of the work I did is with a small camera, and some with the large. We haven't had any of the stuff with the large yet. But, you know, the old architectural camera, I was under the black cloth and it's large film. And so this was very noticeable to the tourists. And I will be set up and wait sometimes for 1 hour till nobody's walking in because it's when the tourists are there. And a group of Germans saw this, and because they were fascinated by the camera because they'd never seen this type of camera, they wanted to know everything about it. And you say, because it was British. Nobody remembers that there were British cameras. It was a British technical camera. So I was telling them about this, and they were saying, ah, you can work with this thing here, are you allowed? I said, yes, I'm given permission. Oh, that's interesting. And I said, and you can photograph inside? Yes, I have the permission. I said, well, it's easier for me because I'm a Muslim, but for example, I knew the BBC film, they had permission, the people who came weren't Muslim, but they were allowed, so it's possible. So they said, this is very beautiful. So I said, yes, that's what I'm trying to show. And they said, so you like this? Yes, it's so beautiful. The Dome of the Rock, it's like a palace. I said to them, well, it's a palace, but it's not for a human being. It's a palace for Allah. It's for God. And they said, well, this is a strange thing. So I said, if you think it's beautiful, what about Islam? They said, oh, Islam is very bad. Islam is terrible. And I said, well, so if you think that, do you think that if this was built by Muslims, can the very bad person do such beauty? And they said, oh, don't tell us this kind of thing. No, this is giving us a problem. No, don't even mention this thing. So they went away confused about this. You know. But this is a fact, you know. And not only that, one thing is, Masjid Al-Aqsa, a lot of the work you found, especially the old work, people spent their lives doing it. And they did it for Sabilillah. Sometimes they were given some small money. It just paid, you know, just for food for their family, nothing else. And it's something that, in a way, we are losing, you know, because life, we think life is so hard. And this, with the light, it's to, this is just in the mihrab. This was the Muslims gathering for prayer. Actually, this is on the Eid. And this is some of the detail. This is carved marble within one of the pillars in one of the many buildings, because Al-Aqsa has so many buildings. This is, and this is in the mihrab, and one of the pillars, and the dome lists all in Al-Aqsa Mosque, not the Dome of the Rock, actually. It's all in Al-Aqsa, and that is the Jami Al-Aqsa. And this is one part, this used to be the Maghribi Mosque in Al-Aqsa, in the corner next to the western side where the Maghribi Quarter was. This was turned into the Islamic Museum. There you go. This just a small brass plaque of Allah. It's on the door of the Dome of the Rock, facing the Qibla. And this is in the cave underneath the rock. So some people say the rock is floating. Well, I've never seen it, but definitely you can go under and you pray there. And it's believed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prayed there. They believe actually there is a ledge here. There's a ledge here. And this one of the oldest mihrabs, because it's flat actually. This is very unusual mihrab. Another detail in Al-Aqsa, and this is carved marble anyway. That you can't see now, actually, the rock where the Prophet went up, alayhi salam. And now, I'll just mention, because there are many, many domes and many prayer. You pray anywhere in Masjid Al-Aqsa, but this one, the Dome of the Spirits, the Dome of the Rock, the Dome of Jibreel, that one there, slightly larger to the right. This actually, the Dome of the Ascension. According to some of the Muslim academics, it could be the Prophet, he went up from that point, not the rock in the Dome of the Rock, but it's very academic, because if you stripped the buildings away, and if you stripped the paving away, this is a mountaintop, you know, and the floor of the Dome of the Ascension is the same stone of the mountaintop, and it is the same rock as the Dome of the Rock. So really, it's like saying, he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, went up into the paradise from there, and it was a bit further. It's all the same there, you know, it's that part there. So this inside the Dome of the Rock, but Al-Aqsa Mosque again. This one of the windows, which one Syrian brother saw this picture and he got angry, because he said, "What's wrong with the Palestinians in the third holy place of Islam? They have the Jewish star." And they say, "What? Who said it's the Jewish star? Is Dawood, was he a Jew? Was he a Muslim? You know, we believe he's a prophet. He was a king. He was a prophet of Islam." And anyway, this is a geometric pattern. This is part of Islamic science. This, the Golden Gate, has been sealed up for over 1,000 years. The Jews say the Muslims sealed it because they believe the Messiah, their Messiah, he's going to enter from that side, and the Muslim blocked it to stop him. But the Muslim also tied this together with the hadith of Dajjal and him having Jewish supporters trying to come and enter the city. Now, there are people who believe this was in Damascus, and there are others who believe it is Jerusalem. But either way, Nabi Isa comes and stops him. When Dajjal sees him, he starts to melt, and he flees. And he's chased by Nabi Isa to the gate of Lud, where he dies. And actually, we don't have that picture in there. There is a picture of him. There is a maqam where it's believed the Dajjal will die, and there is a well inside. It's the only maqam I ever saw. There is a structure with a dome, and inside it there is no grave or supposed grave. It's a well, and they believe this is the place where the Dajjal is finished. So inshallah, it's not too long, because we had enough of some of these things. This also, olives there is in Masjid al-Aqsa. There are gardens and there are cypress trees which have a beautiful perfume. And you notice in Jerusalem a perfume on the air. I don't know if you... And also olives growing in the grounds of the mosque. And you pray next to the olive tree on the earth. It is the same as praying in Masjid al-Aqsa, because it's the sanctuary. And this part of the carved marble designs on the building of Al-Aqsa. And this, the vaulted area on the western side where there were entrances to madrasas, and some of which, actually there's a library there now, that's also where some of the poor families are living. It's very nice to be a poor family. If you wake up for Fajr and you just walk across the courtyard and you pray in Masjid al-Aqsa. Or I visited a brother and you look out his window, the Dome of the Rock is there. This inside the Islamic Museum, one of the Qurans. And the Islamic Museum again. And the Dome of the Rock. What is surprising for me is that if you go there, a lot of people say this is a terrible place, or this is a frightening place, and this is a place full of oppression. But when you go there, it enters your heart. It's a wonderful experience, and you love it, and all you want to do is go back. So, I mean, for me, I feel, I don't know how it is for Palestinians when they are expelled, and this, you know. But what happens is they don't forget, and the generations of them don't forget. This is what the Zionists think, that they're going to forget. You know, they say the old will forget and the young won't know. And I'm afraid they're wrong, you know. And if they were right, we will all become Palestinians anyway.
Let's hope that they acknowledge history one day and remember what we've done. On that note, I'd like to kind of end it, and a big thank you again to Brother Muhsin to kind of doing this presentation and the detailed account of the pictures that he's taken. JazakAllah khair. Assalamu alaikum.